Good afternoon and welcome back. It is Monday, 2 o'clock, and it's time for the Insight Teen Hour. This is the time of the week where we're going to talk about mental health-related issues or teens and mental health. My name is Frederick. I'm from Insight Treatment in Santa Clarita, a teen treatment IOP and PHP program. You're listening to KHTS 98.1 FM. And last week we had, or it was the week before because last week was actually a holiday, but we had Ascend Healthcare here in the studio. We had Seamus and Brittany, who's clinical director for Ascend Healthcare. They came and they talked about residential treatment and how that differs from outpatient treatment and when that's needed and how parents, what parents should expect from residential program. Today we are going to change it around and talk a bit about triangulation. So today I have invited Marissa Escubel, who is a licensed family therapist in Santa Clarita with a private practice in Santa Clarita. And she's here to help us or to talk to the audience here about triangulation. At Insight, we often have to help the entire family. It's a family treatment program because when the teens are struggling, it's usually not just about the teens running into some issues and struggling with some things. It's usually the whole family that needs to be involved. So triangulation, we see a lot. And it's important, I think, for families to understand what that is and how that plays a big role in the family dynamics at home. So that's why I wanted Marissa to come in today and talk to us about that. Welcome to the program, Marissa.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
Yeah. So, Marissa, you are a cool therapist. I know we've spoken quite a bit, but you do things a little bit different, I would say, right? And you have a very sort of straight-up approach to things. You have a website, which I really like, called Codependent Dummy, where you sort of go straight at it and talk to young women about not feeling small and take up some more space and how it's important not to just people-please your entire life, but also remember to focus on yourself, right, and your own needs.
Right.
So that's a very cool website for everybody who's listening to go in and take a look at, I would say. And then, of course, you have your therapywithmarissa.com,
yes,
which is your regular website. But Marissa, tell me a little bit about yourself.
Well, I'm Marissa Escobel. I'm a licensed therapist. I provide talk therapy online to 20-something women. So ever since COVID began, my practice has been virtual, and thanks to that, I serve young women throughout the Los Angeles area, but also Southern California, Northern California, and everywhere in between. I'm a twin. I'm a wife. I'm a new aunt. I'm obviously very focused on my relationships. I am a legacy in the field, so my dad is a licensed social worker, and I love therapy. I love going to my own therapy and just what it can really do, especially when you start earlier, like in your teens and in your young adulthood. You just really get to resolve the issues that maybe were not addressed in hopes that you don't have to repeat them in your own family. And that's the kind of work that I'm passionate about.
Yes, that makes sense. It's definitely important to address things as soon as we can, right? I think we're all learning that in society these days, right? That the quicker we can address some of these issues with the teens, the better is the chance that we can turn things around before
right.
getting ingrained into their behaviors. So
right.
that makes sense. And you live out in Santa Clarita area, right? Or Claremont?
I do not. Yeah, I live,
okay.
So I'm born and raised in Claremont, California, and I am recording live from Claremont as we speak.
Great. But tell me, Marissa, so triangulation, I know you've focused a lot on that. I know you know a lot about it. What is sort of your perspective? Can you maybe explain to us quickly how would you explain it? How would you describe it?
Yes. So I want to start with an example. Well, really a question just for you, Frederick, and your audience members and the listeners. I'm just curious for everyone to reflect on, have you ever felt left out in your family? Okay, that is the question. And I'm going to give an example because triangulation, just it is a fancy term and it sounds so fancy. So an example from my life, a very recent happening in my family, I have a twin sister, I have an older sister. And over quarantine, throughout the pandemic, they have both taken turns being mad at each other, which has led to them not speaking for several months at a time. So we're going 3, 5, 6 months without speaking. And when they finally do talk, my older sister will share a litany of reasons why my twin sister is in the wrong. And to support her litany, she has said things to my twin sister like, well, Marissa feels the same way. Right? So Here's my twin sister, here's my older sister trying to resolve a conflict they're having. I'm not present in the conversation. I'm not a topic of interest in the conversation. And yet I am being brought into the conversation as a unintentional, unconscious effort to decrease the tension, right? So in that moment when my older sister said, well, Marissa feels the same. Now my twin sister isn't only upset with my older sister. Now she might be thinking in the back of her head, what the heck, Marissa? Why do you feel the same way? And so they actually, and this happened, they tried to talk things through. Obviously it didn't go that well. And then my twin sister called me to say, hey, Alana said that you think all these things. And I was like, I never said that. And I didn't, right? I might have just been listening to my older sister and other conversations showing support. But now the conflict between two people it's maybe the amount of anger and tension is slightly less between those two because now it's being directed elsewhere. And there and then that forms a triangle. So it's really when any two-person relationship is unstable, under stress, experiencing tension, and someone else is pulled in, typically to lessen the tension, but it doesn't end up working out most often, Frederick.
No, that's a great description. Maybe I could also add, I would also say that it's not only to lessen the tension, but it could also be to shift the focus, as you said, right? I think with teenagers that are struggling, often there could be a lot of tension, right? When mom finds out that the teenager has not been in school and has been hanging out with the kids that they don't want to hang out with, or has been maybe stolen a bit of money from their wallet or taking the lunch money and used it for something else. In those situations, the kids are very good at diverting that energy and that, you know, focus on them and what they've done to something else. And we often see that. And then they will use triangulation to get drag that into it and sort of create a situation, right, where suddenly the focus and the conversation moves away from whatever's going on to somebody else.
Yeah. I can't help but think, like, maybe the dad allowed some things that mom wasn't privy to in this example. So the teen could say like, well, dad said it was okay. And then boom, like there goes the tension between mom and dad. And the teen is thus left to you know, slowly moonwalk out of the room where the issue isn't really being addressed.
Yes. And I feel that teenagers sort of learn to do this really well, right? Most kids that are in a, you know, that are really struggling and is in a treatment program like ours, at least, they know how to do this exceptionally well, right? They know how to, what exactly what to say to put the focus on that and create tension between mom and dad. And mom and dad are often struggling in the relationship and in their marriage as somewhat of a result of all this stuff that's going on, right? So it's easy to divert that, yeah, dad said I could do this, or dad allowed for this to happen. So, you know, hey, it's not my fault. And then off it goes. So interesting. Good description.
Mm-hmm.
And how would you then, I mean, now we know what it looks like, right?
Right.
How do you work with that in private practice? Do you then, do you do that individually? Do you do that as a family? How do you usually sort of address this when you work with families around it?
That is a great question. It's so hard, right? If I'm working with an individual, how do I work with the two others involved in a triangle? And for starters, I have to recognize, as do practitioners at Insight, as do adolescents and their parents seeking support from professionals like us, triangles, they're a natural part of families.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, Frederick. So there's a mom, dad, and a child. It is a natural breakdown, a natural formation of a family. And sometimes a child will be closer with a parent, sometimes closer with the other parent. Sometimes mom and dad will be doing really well. And so just recognizing that it is a natural part of being a family. And there are benefits to that, right? Like a judge, right, trying a case. It's good to hear both perspectives and have someone weigh in objectively and decide what's best if two people can't come to an agreement. Or
yes,
in offices, if two professionals are having a hard time working together, they can go to someone higher up, get that input. So these are triangles, right, that we deal with culturally, professionally. And so I think first, yeah, I just acknowledge that it is a part of the process that I'm likely going to work with. And yeah, typically, okay, so that's the first part, is just realizing that it's part of the process. It likely will impact therapy. It likely will impact the course of therapy. And being mindful of that, I do my utmost not to create and start a triangle, which I have done in my, you know, baby therapist years. I unintentionally found myself in triangles where I would be the bad guy, or, yeah, it would be me and a teen. We would be more aligned against, right, the evil stepmother or the overbearing father, which long-term was not sustainable because I'm not part of the family. And it really was just a reflection of the uneven, unhealthy dynamics in that family that I was just slowly seeping into. So acknowledging that it's part of it, doing my utmost not to participate, and in my work with teens and families, over time, if I observe a triangle, and most often I do, and it's a reflection of the parents, either mom and dad, or, you know, speaking of being accepting of all types of parents, so just a parent and a parent, a spouse and a spouse, usually the breakdown and what breeds unhealthy triangles, unhealthy triangulation, is the two spouses, the two parents, their relationship being under the most stress and strain. And so I'm not their couples therapist. I'm not technically their family therapist, but I will try to encourage that they seek support to deal with that relationship, right? That dyad, that's what we call it, the two of them, so they won't be so susceptible to their teen's attempts to triangulate, and they also won't unintentionally. Sometimes one parent will rely on a teen as a confidant, which isn't healthy. Sometimes a parent will rely on a teen as a pseudo-spouse, which also isn't healthy, right? They will just get all-consuming with a teen and while neglecting the marriage, neglecting the relationship between the two adults. So I will encourage that. And then also I'll work with my teen to really try and identify if you're having an issue with your mom, if you're having an issue with your dad, if you're having an issue with a sibling, how can you try and attempt to resolve that directly with that person rather than going in this roundabout way via a triangle, right? Because that's where things get broken down is we tend to, you know, we're doing our best, but with my older sister, when she said to my twin, Marissa thinks the same, that wasn't actually helping her and my twin sister get any further in resolving their issues. And so it's really trying to go directly to the person, remaining focused on that person, on the issues, and doing what they can to avoid bringing people into it.
Makes sense. Marissa, yeah. I'm very sorry, but we got to take a little break here. So we'll be back in a couple of minutes. So hang in there. We'll talk more about, you know, hey, what is unhealthy triangulation? What is healthy triangulation? We can talk more about how hard it can be when parents have to stick together around these things and not sort of sometimes maybe even break the trust with the teen as they're doing this to get a healthier dialogue and not feel that codependency about, you know, being your teen's best friend. But we'll be back talking more about this in a few minutes. So hang in there. Okay. You're listening to KHTS 98.1 FM. And this is the Insight Teen Hour. And this is Marissa Escobel, who's talking to us today. Thank you.
Santa Clarita, bedbugs are taking over our city. They've invaded our homes, our businesses, and most importantly, our sleep. If you have suspicious bites that appear nightly or have a bug that you need ID'd, your best option is to make one call to AllPro. We offer a 100% guarantee that your bedbug issues will be solved with heat in one treatment. No need to tent or spray your house with chemicals. Heat is all you need. Call 661-298-2200 or text me a bug picture to 661-645-0540. It's time to sleep tight again, STV.
It's time to enhance your natural beauty at Hestia Medical Spa. Select from a large menu of services, including an assortment of fillers that can be used in the face, lips, hands, and a variety of other body parts. Get rid of that double chin with Kybella, an injectable treatment to permanently destroy fat cells under the chin. Hestia Medical Spa also offers Botox, Dysport, and Xeomin to help reduce severe frown lines. Experience rejuvenation at Hestia Medical Spa, located on Valencia Boulevard next to City Hall. Call 753-3434 or go online to hestiamedicalspa.com.
Your hometown station, KHTS.
There's no combination of words I could put on the back of a postcard. No song that I could sing, but I can try for your heart.
Good afternoon, and welcome back to the Inside Teen Hour. You're listening to KHTS 98.1 FM, and my name is Frederick. I'm from Inside Treatment Program here in Santa Clarita. And today in the studio, I got Marissa Escobel, who is here to talk to us about triangulation and how important it is for parents with teens and young adults to be mindful of triangulation when it happens and use it in a healthy way and understand what it is and when it's coming out in a not so healthy way in the family. So Marissa, thanks for giving us the rundown about, you know, what it is. I feel we got to a point where we were talking a bit about how parents and teens can address these unhealthy triangles and sort of see when it is unhealthy. Can we continue the conversation from there?
Yes. Yeah. So great. I have an example from my own life I sense will help with this.
Great. Let's hear that.
Okay. So I do want to preface this, Frederick, and just let everybody know that I come from what I sense and gather is a long line of triangulation. So my paternal grandmother, she was the mother of six, and I am aware not so much of my father's experience growing up, but as an adult, she would be having an issue with one of her six children, and then she would share with another child, oh, you should have seen how your sister was treating me the other day. And she'd complain about an aunt of mine to another aunt or uncle, and then they would go around and tell my aunt how rude she was being, right? But my grandmother couldn't say directly to one of her children that was rude. And so with this modeling from my grandmother, I sensed that my dad, he did his best, and also he unintentionally, unknowingly, unconsciously put me and my sisters in triangles throughout our adolescence and young adulthood. And he still invites me unknowingly into triangles today, but I know what they are, so thankfully I decline. But, to really relate to the listeners, to those families with teens, an example from my own life, I was 17 years old. I believe I was a senior in high school, applying to colleges. And so I'm applying to colleges. I was captain of the cross country team. I had a very high GPA. It was above a 4.0. I was in theater, extracurriculars, social, and also highly insecure. I didn't know it. Very low self-esteem. I didn't know it. Dealing with imposter syndrome, which I didn't know I had. And I dealt with that the best I knew how. One of the ways was drinking in excess with my friends. And on one occasion, I drank way too much. And they had to take care of me. So I was basically passed out. I got sick. I couldn't really walk. And it was a mess. I was a mess. And my friends proceeded to drop me off at my house. And my dad they were like, Mr. Esquivel, Marissa's passed out in the car. We can't move her. And my dad had to come and carry me into my room. So, right, waking up in the morning, I was guilt-ridden, full of shame, and actually had, right, being Miss Extracurricular, I had an all-day event for school, and somehow my parents allowed me to go. So I went to that, came back in the evening, had a sit down with my parents, and they shared, you know, we're disappointed, we can't believe that you did this, and we aren't going to ground you, but, like, it was, you know, it was kind of them, but yeah, they basically were like, you get to decide your punishment. And mm-hmm. I felt awful. So I think I grounded myself for like 3 months, and I didn't drink, and I was just doing my extracurriculars, getting straight A's. So that's what happened. And mind you, when I got into UC Santa Barbara and I went to school and really struggled, Frederick, for the first, actually, you know, off and on the whole time I was there with partying and drinking to excess. And so it wasn't addressed. And yeah, so how triangulation fits into this, right, the issue actually not being addressed, I grounded myself. And, you know, after a couple months, I went back to partying at times and letting loose and not necessarily making the best choices. But I can't remember specifically the entire context. But in the aftermath, maybe a couple weeks or months later, my dad and I were talking, and he confided in me and shared what it was like for him to tell my mom what had happened, mm-hmm. right? That first conversation when he shared with her, I had to go out and pick Marissa up from the car, and she was, you know, passed out. And he relayed to me that my mom was enraged. And she wanted to ground me for the remainder of my high school year, right? And I think it was in November or December, so we were looking at 6 months. And she was crying, and she raised her voice. And he's telling me this, and then he's like, but I calmed her down.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember... Yes. I remember in that situation, I had multiple feelings and questions came up, right? First of all, my mom never expressed any of these emotions to me, besides disappointment between her and my dad. So I felt awful having caused these feelings. I thought I had caused them, but I didn't know that people have a choice in how they respond. But
absolutely.
Oh my gosh, I can't believe that I did that to mom. And then, my dad saying that he calmed her down, right? So now I appreciate him so much for going to bat for me against the big bad mom. And also, I'm hearing that she wanted to potentially ground me for 6 months. And then later that evening, they just said that I would decide my punishment on my own. And so I just sensed that, I don't know if maybe they were having some strain in their marriage, but overall, I sensed that the remainder of that day, that week, and for years, really off and on, if and when I had a conflict with my mom, I would worry that she wasn't being fully genuine, authentic, and honest with me about how she was feeling and what I could do to address it. And mm-hmm. and then with my dad, it was this weird like, oh, thank you so much. And so it created a closeness with him, but my relationship with my mom in and around that experience and other experiences, it lessened our connection. And so, yeah, right. If I were a therapist and a patient came to me and explained that my dad just confided in me all these things, I would ask her, oh, like, how do you feel about that? How do you feel towards your mom? How do you feel towards your dad? How do you feel about the outcome? And I sense that, yeah, overall, the outcome of my dad's conversation with me, it was not helpful. It was not helpful to know how my mom responded when she didn't necessarily want me to know. It wasn't helpful to know that in a sense, maybe I owed him or I was indebted to him, because this was their mutual decision on how to prescribe that I decide my own punishment. I didn't need to know how they came to that conclusion. And it just taught me, in a way, it modeled, right? This is how you sometimes deal with conflict, or this is how we share about each other in our family. If someone has a strong emotional reaction, sometimes we share it with other people, even if they don't want us to. And so, yeah, so just the ripple effect that conversation and similar conversations had overall left me very confused, very conflicted, and very, you know, the conflicts were not truly resolved.
No. So, would you then, sorry to interrupt you, Marissa, please go ahead.
Yeah. Well, just if I had a patient who came in with this, right, I would encourage her, right, and, you know, maybe she's 17, so she can't, and maybe it would be setting up a family session, but just allowing her to, with everybody present, right, it would be really to have everybody present, mom, dad, and this team, to have her say and recollect a timeline. Okay, I did this. This is a conversation we had. And in a private conversation with dad, he disclosed X, Y, and Z. I'm feeling caught in the middle. I'm feeling uncomfortable. Mom, I didn't know that I had caused such emotion in you. I'm so sorry. And as a family, right, ask my parents, is there anything else that I need to do in order to serve my time? Is there anything else? Because, yeah, right now I'm unsure, or this patient would be unsure if her mom still needed anything addressed. And then as the therapist, I think I would educate them on triangles, explain that I'm observing one currently, and in the future, I would have all of them create some type of code or some type of code word where they could really spot a potential triangle and either try and say hey, so with my twin sister and my older sister, I would tell both my sisters in so many words, this is your issue, and you guys need to resolve this between the two of you. I support you. I encourage you in resolving it, but I can't participate in this. Or as a teen, as a 17-year-old, I think it would have to be the parent and the therapist and her all in one room, but the therapist encouraging them as parents, you two need to decide the punishment. You need to stay on that same page and not share and disclose private conversations between the two of you and how you come up with how to resolve an issue. Because, yeah, long term, it's not healthy.
No, I think that's a great point, Marissa. It really is. I think a lot of parents are doing exactly what you're mentioning, right? We see parents who will agree on some sort of, whether it's a punishment or, but agree on something. But then as they're agreeing and they're sort of saying that they're on the same page, they're expressing that they're on the same page. But then at the same time, mom or dad might feel bad about that decision because they really don't want to go in that direction. and they have a different approach. And then they will express that to the team and say, well, you know, it was Dad who really wanted and I needed to and so and so and so. But to be
and
on the same
so
page.
So uncomfortable, yeah. For that team to know that, it's like, ooh. That's the sound. I'm like, ooh.
Yes.
It's so uncomfortable to be involuntarily placed in the middle of your parents.
Absolutely. That makes a lot of sense. And that's maybe also where I would say that's where a therapist or a treatment program sometimes can be helpful and help parents understand, hey, look, you guys might not agree on this, but it is important to be on the same page. It is important that, hey, this time we're going to do it mom's way or this time we'll do it dad's way. But you guys have to stay united around it. Right. And not start
right.
giving in when the pressure comes from the teen. You know, when the teenager says, but mom, why would you take my phone away at 10 o'clock at night? You don't understand how that interferes in my anxiety if I'm not on social media tonight. You know, I can't go to school tomorrow if I'm not on top of things and if I don't, you know. And then mom goes, well, but, you know, it's because dad feels that this is the way we need to approach. But to have a therapist or a treatment program to be involved with the family when these decisions need to be made so everybody can get an opportunity to talk it through before it's being presented to the team so that everybody, yeah, is on the same page, truly and fully.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. Did you ever, I mean, just on it, because I often feel that kids would be holding back because they wouldn't go to mom and ask, hey, is this how you feel? Because often they would assume something, right? So they would, like in your case, go back and say, well, mom probably did feel that way and go with it from there rather than going and saying, hey, mom, I need to talk to you about something. I need to, you know, we need to address this issue. Can we talk as a family about what you actually feel? And how things were. I think a lot of teenagers would just pull back after a situation like that and you know, keep it to themselves and not move forward with any sort of action. Is that also what
right.
you see or have experienced?
Yeah, I mean, I didn't walk up to my mom. And also, it's hard, but I sense that at least starting out, I would recommend trying to have all three members of the triangle present, because if I've gone directly to my mom, then she might be upset with my dad for telling me, and then it might just snowball from there. And so it mm-hmm. could create another triangle, a triangle on top of a triangle, where now dad's the bad guy who is a gossip about how mom's feeling. So it's, you know, it's such a therapist answer, but like, it depends. But yeah, at
yeah.
the same time, I would also recommend, right, similar to what I've done recently to navigate my sisters and their conflict, I would really try and empower the team that, again, moving forward, like, what's our code word for if and when we spot a triangle, and to really empower him or her to say, Dad, you're doing it again. And then hopefully for Dad to be able to acknowledge, like, oh, yeah, sorry. And it's like, you know, that's adult stuff. And I'm grounded, or I'm doing whatever I need to do to make up for when I messed up. But that's between you and mom, because that, you know, I'm 33. Now I'm able to do that on Super Bowl Sunday. My dad unintentionally was like, he didn't say this, but he was like, you want to get in a triangle with me and mom? That's basically what he asks. And I said, no, thank you. But I'm 33. I'm a therapist. I've been doing this for, you know, close to a decade. And so, yeah, it would be at least trying to empower the teen to say, like, this is between you and mom, or like, hey, Dad, you're doing it again. Remember the therapist? You can always say the therapist. The therapist said we can't we can't talk like this. Let's wait till we have our family meeting or something. So also setting something in place maybe once a week or once a month where everyone can bring an issue to the table. So there is a time to really try and refocus away from triangles just because you are in each other's presence trying to resolve things as a team.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yeah.
Well, I'm sorry, Marissa, we got to go into a little break again. You're listening to KHTS 98.1 FM, and this is the Insight Teen Hour. We'll be back in a few minutes, and we'll talk more about triangulations and how it can affect a family negatively and how people get stuck in these triangles. And Marissa is going to give us some information as to how we can get out of it and how we can sort of clear the air sometimes and get the facts on the table. So thank you, Marissa. We'll be back in a few minutes.
KHTS strives to give the Santa Clarita Valley all the information they need, and when our computers aren't working the way they should, we call Resurgence, your true source for IT. Resurgence provides outstanding customer service while also providing the highest technical ability. They strive to do what's best to improve and protect your business. For more information on Resurgence, call 349-4114 or visit resurgenceit.com.
SCVI is a tuition-free TK through 12 charter school that gives your child boundless opportunities to think critically and imagine freely. We offer a customized learning program built around your child's unique interests and strengths with the only international baccalaureate program in all of Santa Clarita. Our approach keeps students and families in step no matter where your learning is taking place. Be empowered to make your mark on the world at SCVI. To take a tour or enroll now in our one-of-a-kind program, visit iLeadSantaClarita.org. iLead Schools, free to think, inspired to lead.
I listen to it all day, every day.
Hometown, your hometown station.
There's no combination of words I could put on the back of a postcard. No song that I could sing, but I can try for your heart. Our dreams, and they are made out of real things, like a shoebox of photographs with sepia tone.
Good afternoon, and you're listening to the Insight Teen Hour. So Marissa and I were talking about triangulation, and obviously it is easy to address in a family where people are open to the idea that it's happening and sort of open to the idea of fixing it. But I also feel an insight that we see a lot of families where there's a sort of an ingrained resistance to try and change these things around. Basically, there is sometimes mom has a codependency with the teen or a relationship with the teen that they're so scared of letting go of. They feel that it's crucial that the teen or the young adult will continue to open up and express some of their concerns or worries to mom, and they're scared that they're going to break this trust if they are not able to sometimes, you know, let's just call it this way, they sometimes not let dad hang out to dry or blame it on dad or somebody else in the family. How do you, Marissa, how do you sort of tackle that when there's a real deep down resistance, or I should rather say, when people are really scared of letting go of this tool that they have created that seems to be working for them, how do you address that, and what would you say to families?
Well, my first thought is, as you were talking, Frederick, a montage of teens and families that I've worked with are flashing before my eyes. And the unfortunate truth is that in my attempts to empower some of the teens and young women I've worked with, in my attempts to involve a family in family therapy in order to address unhealthy patterns of interaction like triangulation, in my attempts to, you know, change the system, so sometimes we talk about family systems, like, you know, the solar system has 8 planets, family systems have however many members, and we're trying to change how they're, the formations, I've lost patience, Frederick. I've had families
yes.
quit. What I thought was an amazing session of change and insight and realizations, and then I'll get a call the next week from a parent who is too close and maybe
yes.
triangulated and dad is left out to dry, or I'll get a text from a father who you know, upon further reflection, does not agree with my assessment of his poor interactions with a teen, and
mm-hmm.
they quit. And so I don't know if I actually help everyone, but I think if anything, with especially those teens and families who maybe start and face resistance, what I have experienced in, you know, my young career, I have not been doing this that long, but I have been contacted maybe a year, 2 years, 3 years after I was working with a teen, after I was working with a family, and they will come back.
Mm-hmm.
And like they'll admit, like, hey, like we didn't appreciate your feedback, and also we have continued to interact with each other the same way. We remember you said some things and did some things that really helped in the short term, and we're back for that. So I sense that for practitioners and also for families who maybe start and stop, I do and am comforted knowing that I am.
Frederick, I think we lost her for a second.
Oh, okay. She will probably call back in. But I think, are we still on the air,
Patty? We're still on. We're still on. We're talking.
Okay. Sorry to everybody out there. But, yeah, no, I think I can follow up with that and say, yes, as treatment providers, often I think we have to make sure that we stay honest to what we feel and call people out in a compassionate way. And treatment can be hard and uncomfortable. And sometimes families might not be ready for it. And it's important to acknowledge that we often are trying to plant some seeds that we then are hoping will grow later on. And I think that that's what Marissa was talking about, was how her approach sometimes can be a little, you know, sometimes families are not ready for it, but you're planting a seed, and later on a family or a teen will realize, well, that was what was being talked about, and then is ready for it at a later stage. Marissa, did you come back on the air?
Doesn't seem
nope,
like
not,
she did.
Not yet.
Not yet.
But I think it is, again, back to the idea that I think in treatment, it is so important to continue to call out these triangulations when it happens and to support families, not, you know, to support parents
okay.
to avoid it. And to explain when this happens and ensure communication in the family, because that's another piece that Marissa and I didn't get a chance to talk about. But often teenagers do not want to sit down and have a family chat every Monday at 1 o'clock for an hour and talk about some of these things. Obviously, many teens, part of being a teenager, is to sort of shut down a little bit and leave it alone and move on and go and talk to their own friends. So it can be very hard to have these conversations, and it can be hard and challenging to sometimes get the kids to open up about how they feel about certain things.
She should be back in now, Frederick.
That doesn't manifest itself. Marissa, are you back?
I am back.
Hooray.
Good job.
And we have
great
about have two more minutes, by the way, guys. We have two more minutes just to make sure you guys
yeah.
know.
Yes. So, Marissa, I was just saying that, you know, sometimes setting up, you know, a time every Monday to talk with the teenagers and sort of expecting that the teens or the young adults will start talking about how they feel about certain issues that come up in the family obviously sometimes can be hard, right? It's not all the time that teenagers is willing to open up about it and come forward about things. But I think, unfortunately, our time is about to be up, Marissa. I really enjoy having you on the show. And thanks for making this.
I really enjoyed being here.
Great. You talked about this in a way I think we can all understand it and gave some great examples. So thanks for that. Marissa, here in the end, if anybody would like to learn more or get in touch with you, how would they do that? How can they reach out to you?
I would encourage them to go to my website. It's www.therapywithmarissa.com, and it's M-A-R-I-S-S-A. And yeah, Frederick also talks about Codependemy. That's for my podcast, the Codependemy podcast, all about codependency in young women. They can check that out wherever podcasts are found.
I love that website. You're very straightforward. I really like it. You call it as it is, and I can recommend everybody to go there. It's a great site, I feel.
Thank you. Yeah, I just celebrated 1 year of the show, and a lot of personal examples to help my listeners understand concepts like triangulation and other, you know, everything else. Like, related to psychology, but through practical stories from my life and also having experts on to explain.
Yeah, it's great. Great resource. Thank you very much, Marissa, for all the hard work you do. And we will be in touch.